Everybody to the Institute for Historical Studies Online at UT Austin, to a panel on Rodney King and the Los Angeles Riots 30 years later, a commemoration and retrospective event. Now, this event this panel commemorates an iconic event that could not be more salient today as we witness the trial of Derek Chauvin for the murder of George Floyd, namely the police beating of Rodney King in LA 30 years ago on March 3rd, 1991. As many of us remember, members of the LA Police Department who participated in the brutal beating of Rodney King were acquitted at their trial a year later, setting off 6 days of rioting by enraged Blacks and Latinos. Today's panel will focus on the all too familiar issue of police brutality toward minorities. I'd like to note, given current concerns about another minority, racism directed at Asian Americans, that among the victims of the rioting were many Korean American shopkeepers whose businesses were destroyed in violence that continued for several days, in part because the LA police refused to provide protection. So that's a different issue, and it's one that I hope there will be an opportunity in the future to address the complex issues involving middlemen, minority groups, and the ongoing blight in many minority neighborhoods, but that is not for today. We have an exceptional roster of speakers, all of them public historians whose voices and faces are familiar to many of you. Because we want to leave maximum time for questions, I'll introduce them very briefly, which is too bad because their achievements are numerous and it would be very pleasant to enumerate them, but I'm going to just be very brief. I will introduce them in the order they will be speaking in. Dr. Peniel Joseph is Barbara Jordan Chair in Ethics and Political Values, Professor of History and Founding Director of the Center for the Study of Race and Democracy at the University of Texas at Austin. He holds a joint professorship appointment at the LBJ School of Public Affairs and the History Department in the College of Liberal Arts. He's also the founding director of the LBJ School Center for the Study of Race and Democracy. His career focus has been on Black Power studies. Prior to joining the UT faculty, Dr. Joseph was a professor at Tufts University, where he founded the School Center for the Study of Race and Democracy. Dr. Joseph's most recent book, The Sword and the Shield, The Revolutionary Lives of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr., has been widely reviewed, and he also wrote the award-winning books Waiting Till the Midnight Hour, A Narrative History of Black Power in America, and Dark Days, Bright Nights, From Black Power to Barack Obama. He's also written a biography of Stokely Carmichael. He will speak on the 1992 Los Angeles Rebellion and the evolution of Black Power. The second speaker, Dr. Monica Munoz Martinez, is associate professor in the Department of History at Austin. She received her PhD in American Studies from Yale and her AB from Brown University. Her first book, The Injustice Never Leaves You, Anti-Mexican Violence in Texas, was awarded 7 prizes. Yes, 7, I believe. Is that correct, Monica?
That's correct.
Okay. She's the primary investigator for Mapping Violence, Racial Terror in Texas, 1900 to 1930, a digital project that recovers histories of racial violence in Texas. This multifaceted project includes a digital archive of histories of racial violence, research for each documented case, curated content, and an interactive map. Dr. Martinez is also a founding member of the award-winning nonprofit organization Refusing to Forget. It calls for a public reckoning with racial violence in Texas. She will speak on the topic Under Cloak of Legal Authority, Police Violence, and Racial Terror in Texas. And finally, Dr. Leonard Moore, who is the executive director of the initiative Historically Black Colleges and Universities at UT, and George W. Littlefield Professor of American History at UT. All three are UT faculty members. Dr. Moore earned his BA from Jackson State University in 1993 and his PhD from Ohio State University in 1998. He was history professor at Louisa State University from 1998 to 2007, where he also directed the African and African American Studies Program and the Pre-Doctoral Scholars Institute. He's been at the University of Texas since 2007 and was made permanent vice president in 2018. At UT, he teaches a class on the Black Power Movement and a signature course titled Race in the Age of Trump. He's received a number of teaching awards. And in 2004, he was awarded the National Urban League Whitney M. Young Award for Urban Leadership in Education. Before taking his present position, he served as Vice President for Diversity and Community Engagement. He's the author of three books on Black politics, The Defeat of Black Power, Civil Rights, and the National Black Political Convention of 1972, Black Rage in New Orleans, Police Brutality and African-American Activism from World War II to Hurricane Katrina, and Carl B. Stokes and the Rise of Black Political Power in America. And he will speak on the topic From Cleveland to Compton, the Moore Family and the Second Great Migration. So just before we start, I'd just like to note that participants in the audience can at any point during this event post questions using the Q&A feature on Zoom. And that's helpful. That's actually helpful to us if you pose those questions early so that we can deal with the questions rationally so that Brittany can. And if you would like to ask the question yourselves, let us know that and we can arrange for that in terms of the logistics, the Zoom logistics needed. Okay, so without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Joseph.
Thank you. Thank you, Miriam. And thanks to my fellow co-panelists. I'm eager to hear your thoughts on this subject. What I want to talk about really just for 18 minutes and then give myself a 2-minute wrap up is Black Power and the LA rebellions. I think we're remiss when we call these riots. These were not riots. These are urban rebellions. I think we're remiss when we talk about minority populations. Third world people are global majorities. So all those are rhetorical errors. I've been railing against for decades, even when I was in high school as a political activist. I look at the King Rebellion through the lens of a 19-year-old Haitian American school because of my mother, Jermaine Joseph, on East 92nd Street, Mount Sinai Hospital, who's a trade unionist for over 40 years. What happened in Los Angeles, April 29th, 1992, what Ice Cube, the hip hop artist, says power to the people, was really the outgrowth of decades of anti-Black racism, decades of structural violence against Black communities. But there's also, and this is what I want to talk about today, we think about Black power. How is it defined? Well, when we think about the Black Power movement in the context of Malcolm X, Angela Davis, Stokely Carmichael, Kathleen Cleaver, and the Black Panthers, there's a couple of different ways to think about Black power. And when we think about 1992, and there's more than a couple, but I want to talk about sort of grassroots Black power versus Black electoral power and Black political power in a mainstream sense. I think by 1992 and what the rebellion shows, and when we look at it 30 years later, we sort of see the consequences of both approaches. By 1992, the approach that's winning out is much more of an electoral approach rather than a grassroots approach. When we look at Rodney King and the beating of Rodney King, when we look at the murder of Latasha Harlan the previous year in 1991, the 15-year-old Black girl who was murdered by a Korean grocer in Los Angeles for being Black. You know, there's always an allegation of theft, but it was really for being Black. These were the byproducts of decades of structural violence and white supremacy. But what's so interesting about 1992 is that by 1992, we no longer were speaking in a unified voice against the roots of urban rebellions. Martin Luther King Jr. famously said that we needed to look at urban, what authorities call urban riots or civil disturbances, as the language of the unheard, the language of people who are being racially and economically oppressed and politically disenfranchised, and also brutalized and murdered by the police. We remember that after the Chicago police riot and white supremacist riot of 1919, that's where we get one of the first official police reports about an anti-Black racial pogrom. And that continues in terms of the Kerner Commission. It continues in terms of the McCone Commission after 1965. So these are real decades of structural violence, both physical violence, but political violence and disenfranchisement against Black people that lead to political rebellions. You know, Stokely Carmichael, other Black power activists described what happened in Los Angeles in 1965, in Newark and Detroit in 1967 as urban rebellions, that people shouldn't look at them as just violent riots or mobs, because they were really these insurrections that were growing out of decades of structural abuse. When we think about it in that context, what's fascinating about LA and the next 30 years is the way in which both vectors of Black political power doubled down on their perspectives. Those who were Black elected officials doubled down on this sort of top-down view of Black politics. And we're thinking about people who were connected to the Clinton administration, people who've been connected to Democratic neoliberal politics. Some of those folks have since switched course. Some of those folks didn't get the federal jobs they were after. Some of those folks became radicalized by being unable to integrate in what Malcolm X called a burning house. Others absolutely doubled down and really looked upon 1992 as a lesson that Black people needed to acquire more mainstream political power. Others, and this is where one of the most interesting aspects of the current movement for Black Lives, Black Lives Matter movement, really continued to organize at the grassroots level. And in Los Angeles, we're thinking about groups like Justice for Janitors, Bus Riders Union. You're thinking about many different grassroots Black feminists, Black queer, other organizers who continue to organize at the grassroots level, not just against police brutality, but really organize in the tradition of what W.E.B. Du Bois in Black Reconstruction called abolition democracy. In this context, to abolish the police, to abolish prisons, to abolish the carceral state, abolish poverty, and at the same time, produce real democracy by expanding not just voting rights, but expanding dignity and citizenship for Black people who were forced to live in racially segregated, economically impoverished communities. And so what's really interesting in the subsequent three decades is how both of those groups, on one level, we could say the election of Barack Obama represents an apex for the group that felt that Black elected political power was really the game changer that African Americans needed to be able to transform their position. And in contrast, we can say that the apex, especially in 2020, of a movement for Black Lives with Black Lives Matter 2.0 in the context of George Floyd's murder, and we've got the Derek Chauvin trial happening right now, really showing that this idea of grassroots political power is what was needed, right? That it wasn't going to be electoral power. It wasn't going to be a top-down perspective, but it needed to come from the bottom up. And we've seen that in Ferguson and Baltimore and last year, just nationally. And very quickly, when we think about Black political power, I want to talk about LA in the context of the carceral state and the criminal justice system, but really in the context of the carceral state and the criminal justice system and its relationship to panoramic systems of oppression. Michelle Alexander has called the criminal justice system the new Jim Crow, but it really goes beyond the criminal justice system. So the potency of the Black Lives Matter argument beyond the demonstrations, but we're thinking about the policy agendas, the proposals, has been the argument that the criminal justice system in the United States represents a gateway to panoramic systems of oppression that are connected to racially segregated schools, that are connected to a surveillance state in schools and poor Black neighborhoods and neighborhoods of color, that are connected to lack of access to healthcare and mental health care and wellness and environmental racism and injustices that are once encapsulated by the criminal justice system, but also go far beyond and transcend them, that have tentacles, right, like an octopus, into many, many slices of people's lives and their futures. And what's so, I think, fascinating is that when we go back to 1992, you're gonna find activists saying the same thing. They didn't call themselves a movement for Black lives. They didn't call themselves Black Lives Matter, but they were anti-racist racial justice activists who were arguing that what happened to Rodney King was connected to these global neoliberal policies of not just the Clinton regime, but the Bush-Reagan regime and these previous regimes. And something needed to happen, something needed to change. I think what's so interesting about Los Angeles in 92 is that Black communities are split on what needs to change. We can remember Jesse Jackson and others going down to Los Angeles, and some of them are, yes, criticizing structures of violence, but they're also criticizing Black people and criticizing Black bodies and saying somehow it is the fault of Black people. They're criticizing Black men and saying it's the fault of the Black family and Black men not being able to be recognized as patriarchal authorities, right? So this is a vision of Black freedom where the problem with Black folks is that they don't have enough Black patriarchal power. And some Black men actually believe this and buy into this, right? Even to this day, when you think about Ice Cube and other people, they're buying into this. So what's so interesting is that this idea that Black lives matter and we're supposed to criticize structures and institutions of racial oppression by 1992, and in a way, 92 represents a midway point between 1966 and the Black Power movement. When we think about Stokely Carmichael, Greenwood, Mississippi, June 16th, 1966, and really a movement for Black Lives Matter right where we're at. And in that midway point, you really get real conflict in the sense of why is there this kind of enduring, these enduring systems of oppression. Some people are calling it, even in the Black community, a riot. We just like the cliche of Black on Black crime, we got this in the 60s and we get it now, this idea of why are we destroying our own communities? Instead of saying, why are these communities racially segregated and economically impoverished, yet other communities are not? Is it just a question of biology and Black people and destiny and Black people are predetermined to live this way? Or is it larger forces of racial capitalism and structural racism and systemic white supremacy aided and abetted by neoliberal policies that are enforced by law enforcement that has a demarcated color line, right? And so what's really extraordinary for us looking back 30 years later is that we see the seeds for both a movement for Black lives. We see the seeds for fake police reform. When we think about LAPD, people saying, hey, we're gonna change these things and change policing practices, where even if people make arguments for change, the system is is irretrievably corrupt as is. And 30 years later, there's still police brutality and rampant segregation and law enforcement malfeasance and violence. And we saw this during protests in 2020, both in LA, but all across the United States. And then finally, in terms of Black power, I think one of the most interesting aspects is the evolution of Black power from 1992 to the present. In contrast to the period that we are in now, where we've seen sort of perhaps the most diverse slate of Black political leaders in the context of George Floyd's death, especially those led by Black women, those who are queer. In 92, even at the grassroots, we saw that diverse leadership publicly. In a lot of ways, it was the usual suspects. Publicly, the imagery and the iconography was still very, very specifically patriarchal in a very, very specific way. And when we think about even elected officials hemmed and hawed at the same time that they talked about the need to have some kind of anti-poverty and social justice programs, they still criticize Black people and Black bodies and Black families without having a context and understanding for the structural violence and the challenges and the conflicts and the impediments that those communities faced in 1992 and continue to face. So very quickly, with the time that I have left, what are some of the lessons of 1992 for those of us living in 2021? Well, I think one of the biggest lessons is this idea that, and we've continued to see it in the past 18 months, that the only time federal officials in the nation is willing to try to talk or discuss or consider Black lives is in the context of crisis. So one of the things that LA does is continue that script. I think in certain ways, the election of Barack Obama upends that script, but then Obama says he's just a president who happens to be Black and doesn't want to be a Black president. So we're sort of back to that script. And that script is one of silence and omissions about Black life and the lack of full citizenship and dignity for African Americans in the United States. When we think about that crisis paradigm, certainly the 1960s are full of it. And after that, in the 30 years in between 1992 and 2021, what we've seen is sort of these intermittent crises. We've seen uprisings and rebellions in not just Los Angeles in 92 being the biggest, but also in Cincinnati in the early aughts. Hurricane Katrina continued the crisis paradigm. Certainly, the election of Obama and the re-election tried to upend that paradigm. But then the subsequent deaths, especially during his second administration, of Michael Brown and Sandra Bland, Breonna Taylor, Rakisha Boyd, so many different Black girls and boys, young men, young women, who were literally slaughtered by the police and law enforcement, set up another paradigm of crisis. But what's striking in contrast to both LA and even BLM, LA in 1992, LA in 1965, BLM in 2014-15, is that 2020 showed you the biggest uprising in American history. 15 to 26 million are the estimates, but so many were white that this problem became considered sort of a national emergency, at least for a time in the spring and summer of 2020. And for a time, this has changed. These public opinion polls wax and wane and they've gone down. But for a time last summer, in summer of 2020, you saw the BLM movement have striking positive public opinion. And a lot of that had to do with, for the first time, this was perceived as a national problem in a different way. It wasn't a problem that was just ghettoized. So even though there was still a crisis framework, that crisis didn't ebb during 2020. And this is connected to COVID-19 and the racial disparities This is connected to the most racially divisive presidential election in modern history. It's connected to the continued, and the data shows us that 2020 was one of the most violent years for both gun violence, but also people of color dying at the hands of the police, in spite of all the attention paid to George Floyd and Breonna Taylor. So it's interesting. And one of the things I'd love to discuss when we're doing Q&A is this evolution in terms of the crisis model, these different strains of Black political power, top down versus radical grassroots. And really, what does this rebellion say about American democracy and these myths and lies of American exceptionalism? I'll close by saying one of the things that 1992 shows us is in stark reality, the lie of American exceptionalism. And this is important because Black political power at the electoral level is also invested in the lie of American exceptionalism. And what is that lie? American exceptionalism, this idea that America is the greatest place on earth. It's, you know, P.T. Barnum time, the greatest show on turf, right? The greatest place on earth. And a place where Barack Obama said November 4th, 2008, a place where all things are possible. Not for most Black people. But that lie of American exceptionalism, like James Baldwin has argued, is based on, really, it's two lies. One is the dehumanization that allows for racial slavery and the building of global capitalism, and the murder and slaughter and decimation and the rape and sexual assault of Black people to build up global capitalism. The Dred Scott case, convict lease, the whole thing. So that's one part of the big lie. The movement for redemption, the Redeemer South. The second lie is that the first lie never happened, right? Right. So the second lie is that the first lie never happened, right? And so to run for office in this country, you have to lie and say that America is a place where all things are possible, and you put aside not just the urban rebellions, but American violence, centuries of violence, especially against Black people, certainly brown people and others, Asian Americans, so many different people, but anti-Blackness is the organizing principle of the caste system in the United States. So one interesting way to end this is to think about the urban rebellion as one of the biggest exemplars of giving proof to the lie of American exceptionalism that we continue to carry with us in 2021. But as we've seen with the January 6th white supremacist assault on the nation's capital, the United States is an international and global joke. It's an embarrassment because people see that any place where white supremacy is the coordinating principle and the beating heart of their democracy is not a democracy. And like Malcolm X argued, is nothing more than US hypocrisy. Thank you.
Thank you, Peniel. Let's move right away to the next speaker, Dr. Martinez.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for the invitation. I'm so grateful to the team that put this together and so grateful to be in conversation with these esteemed, my colleagues, my panelists, my fellow panelists. Today, I want us to think about the long history of police violence and police violence in Texas, reflecting on the violence suffered by Rodney King and all of those who witnessed the event requires us to place police violence squarely within our focus when we're thinking about racial terror. When we think about racial redress and healing for racial violence, we tend in the United States to think almost exclusively about the history of lynchings and vigilante violence. But racial terror throughout our history, but certainly in the 20th century, included violence by mobs, including lynchings, and racially motivated homicides by individuals, by neighbors, by regular people, by women and men. But racial terror also included things like church bombings, cross burnings, torture, police torture, and assault and intimidation. And so thinking about the beating of Rodney King in the 1990s asks us to consider the longer history of that kind of violence that for too long has been overlooked because it didn't lead to death, right? That his beating to historians who were studying cases of racial terror in the early 20th century might not even have been collected. And so if we had been thinking about if his assault had taken place in the early 20th century. And so as a historian, I'm thinking about recovering cases of racist violence in Texas that for too long have been overlooked, in part because they were cloaked in illegal authority, because it was violence at the hands of police. So law enforcement officers played a key role as aggressors, but also in making racial and ethnic victims vulnerable to violence. So again, I wanna ask us in reflecting on the violence suffered by Rodney King to consider the history of police violence in creating a climate of racial terror, but also more specifically using violence to curtail civil rights efforts. And this builds on Dr. Joseph's points about having to really reframe how we think about the role of police in actively working to curtail, intimidate, and stop civil rights advances and gains for people living in the United States, but certainly in Texas. Texas is a troubling history. It's a troubling place to study this violence because it has intersecting histories of slavery, genocidal violence, violence that targeted indigenous groups, but also violence targeting Mexican nationals and American citizens, and also anti-Chinese violence, especially by border agents that were enforcing policies like the Chinese Exclusion Act that was passed in 1882. So when we think about trying to understand racial terror in all of its forms, suffered by multiple sets of victims, Texas is a place to do this kind of work. I'm going to share a slideshow so that I can keep to time, try to introduce you to some primary sources, historical events, but also to introduce you to what we don't know about histories of racist violence in Texas and the ongoing recovery work that is required. So here we go. Okay, so title slide. All right, so I am working with a group of collaborators to actually try to think about what it would look like to build a national record of racist violence in the 20th century. We don't have anything close to a national record of racist violence in the 20th century in the United States. And studying racial terror in the 20th century is important because it's that connective history that helps us to understand the genocidal violence, the colonization, the history of slavery in the 19th century with ongoing racial violence and inequality that we are living with today. And so when we're thinking about the need for this kind of recovery work, it helps to fill the gaps between the history that we need to consider with the history of slavery, genocidal violence targeting Native people, and colonization, and what we see today currently playing out in different forms of racial inequality and racial violence. We also have to record a more expansive record of racist violence to even try to quantify widespread historical trauma. Right. So if we think about the thousands of victims of lynchings and police murder that took place in the 20th century, we also have to consider the thousands of people that witnessed those acts and that lived in the aftermath. And so when I'm watching the George Floyd media coverage and I'm watching, you know, this prosecution of Officer Chauvin, you know, it's gripping the testimonies that are required by the witnesses and the kind of pain that you hear being articulated. And also the moments during those testimonies when the emotions are being uttered and expressed that you see the court stopping those kinds of statements, particularly from the young minority, the minors that are testifying. So when we think about recovering a record of racist violence, we have to move beyond just thinking about individual victims, but trying to actually consider the widespread terror and trauma that has been experienced, but also passed from generation to generation. This work also requires that we study patterns of police violence, violence and injustice at the local level, at the state level, and at federal levels. And so some of the work that I'm doing with a recovery project called Mapping Violence is not only to try to recover cases of racial violence that targeted different racial and ethnic groups, but also to track information data about the aggressors themselves. And so I'm going to share some examples of what we learn when we start to actually build archives of police violence and see things like individual police officers who are Texas Rangers traveling around different parts of the state, targeting different racial groups. You know, a young African-American man in Austin is shot and killed by James Monroe Fox, who's a Texas Ranger, who later poses in 1915 with next to dead Mexican bodies, and later is the captain who oversees the company that that organizes the Bloody Massacre in 1918 in West Texas. And so it's important when we think about police as agents and aggressors of violence that they leave traces and records that we can actually turn to study these patterns of violence. I also think that we have to recover these kinds of cases in efforts to design racial redress efforts and to fully reckon with histories of racist violence, to inform policy and institutional reform, and to chart a more equal future. You know, we're in a moment where people are thinking about how we reckon with the histories of slavery, how we reckon with racial inequality. And I really firmly believe that we only have a glimpse into the atrocities that took place, not only in the 19th century, but also more recently in the 20th century. And again, it is because of that cloak of authority by law that law enforcement for too long have enjoyed that the kinds of crimes, brutality, and atrocities that they committed have been understood by the public as just use of force, and because the victims themselves have been so thoroughly criminalized by the media, by historians, and by Hollywood. So some of the collaborators that I've been working with, let's see, oh, I never pressed play. Here we go. Some of the collaborators that I've been working with, Margaret Burnham, for example, who leads the Civil Rights and Restorative Justice Project. She and her team of a legal clinic at Northeastern School of Law have been building a case, a national record of this is their national case map down at the bottom left, of racial homicides that include violence by police and police killings, in addition to lynchings. And in the center of the slide, you see a preliminary test map of just the Birmingham police killings that they found in Birmingham. And they've also done incredible, incredible work working with descendants of these murders to find, in some cases, to pursue criminal justice, but also to pursue restorative justice by other means in terms of memorialization and other projects. Jeff Ward is a sociologist who runs with his colleague David Cunningham the Racial Violence Archive, and they've been charting in the South, the U.S. South, and mapping, in addition to lynchings and in racially motivated homicides, events like church bombings and cross burnings and other forms of racial terror that give us a closer glimpse into, again, these ideas of what it meant to live in a climate of racial terror, but also doing really incredible work in terms of charting things like counties that had high numbers of lynchings, that then he looks at the statistics to show how often those counties then have more egregious policies in schools of corporal punishment, right, to trace the way that racist violence manifests in other forms after lynchings decline. And I've been working, as I said, with a group of students at Brown University. Now I'm so glad to be bringing this project to UT Austin to build a Mapping Violence and Recovery project here at UT, but also working with colleagues in Refusing to Forget to try to commemorate the cases of anti-Mexican violence that we know in Texas and really partner with descendants who have been trying and struggling for generations to have these histories acknowledged by the state, because these were state-sanctioned killings, right? These were murders that took place by U.S. soldiers, Texas Rangers, local law enforcement, and civilians that were sanctioned by governors and state representatives and by the public and the press. Again, for thinking about the histories of racist violence in the United States, too often these histories are segregated. And so the history of lynchings is broadly understood as taking place in the U.S. South, and the history of anti-Mexican lynchings is broadly understood as taking place in the Southwest. But again, Texas provides us an opportunity to study how these histories really intersected, and again, to go beyond just vigilante violence. So just very briefly, anti-Mexican violence in Texas, again, is victims were, people were victims of vigilante violence as well as by state-sanctioned violence. It's estimated that between 1848 and 1932, at least 232 ethnic Mexicans were lynched by mobs in Texas. Hundreds more were murdered by Texas Rangers, local law enforcement, US soldiers, and vigilantes between 1910 and 1920 alone. And that only gives us a study of that, of police violence in just that decade. Anti-Black violence in Texas was also atrocious. Between 1889 and 1930, Texans lynched at least 400 victims. The NAACP reported that Texas was third in the nation in terms of anti-Black lynchings, third only to Georgia and Mississippi. These numbers, of course, excluded victims of police violence or vigilante violence on a smaller scale. And so we really only have a glimpse into racially motivated homicides targeting African-Americans in Texas. 1919 provides a really important opportunity for thinking about the social justice efforts that took place in the early 20th century to try to turn the course of history. One of the examples is that in 1919, Texas, there was a Texas Ranger investigation that was held by the state of Texas. It was called for by House Bill 5, which was filed by State Representative Jose T. Canales, who was from South Texas. Canales called for an investigation into ranger abuse, right? This is this Texas State Police Force. It included 19 charges of Texas ranger abuse that ranged from denying residents due process, torturing prisoners, murdering unarmed prisoners, and coordinating massacres like the Breonna massacre. He also suggested reforms like reducing the force by removing abusive rangers, rangers that were had been documented to commit murders and abuse. He also thought that you could reform the state by increasing salaries and by placing rangers under bond so that if they committed abuse or crimes, there were possibilities to seek redress other than just criminal charges. The evidence for this investigation spanned a total of 2 weeks. 83 people, witnesses testified. The hearings resulted in 3 volumes of evidence that are currently preserved by the Texas State Archive. And this archive is invaluable because it preserves the testimonies, not only of people who witnessed or suffered or were victims themselves, but also it includes the testimonies of people who called for racist violence, who called for brutality and murder by the Texas State Rangers against Mexicans, anybody who looked Mexican, regardless of their citizenship or their place or their standing. And also they used their citations in this investigation where some congressmen who were trying to make sense of anti-Mexican violence turned to anti-Black lynchings as a way to explain the kinds of quick action that was required of policing racial groups like Black and Mexicans in Texas. So Claude B. Hudspeth was from West Texas, and he was one of these legislators who testified. He was a congressman who testified in 1919, "You've got to kill those Mexicans when you see them or they will kill you." The investigation has extensive records of survivors and witnesses that were seeking justice that left a rich archive of depositions, testimonies. They also left an archive of survivors that filed claims against the United States government for charging them with things like denial of justice. This is a testimony that was submitted by Eulalia Gonzalez Hernandez. She was a widow of one of the 15 men and boys that was murdered at the Breonna massacre in 1918 in police custody. This is a dying declaration of Toribio Rodriguez, who was shot and killed on multiple occasions by Texas Rangers, who gave his dying testimony. And you also have here not only the translation of his testimony, of his dying declaration, but also the names of all of the witnesses of people who witnessed either the shooting or who cared for him in the aftermath. And who wanted to, who helped to participate in creating a record of his murder. There's also examples of anti Black violence by Texas Rangers in the investigation. Thomas A. Johnson lived in San Angelo, Texas. He was arrested and accused of theft. Texas Rangers participated in stealing him away in their custody and moving him to Sweetwater, where he was beat and intimidated and threatened with mob violence. His wife, upon hearing that he had been removed and was somewhere in police custody, feared the worst and hired an attorney to actually help find him and ultimately secured his release and proved that he was innocent of all charges. And so there's a testimony both of Thomas Johnson himself, but also of W.A. Anderson, the attorney. And this is an example of more of the mundane kinds of police violence, again, that didn't end in a lynching, didn't end in death, but is you can find in the records, right, that the records are replete with this kind of violence by police. The congressional report that was released, unfortunately, admitted to the kinds of crimes by the Texas Rangers. It also criminalized Mexican nationals and Mexican Americans and created, you know, fear, further fear of the border. It called for the reduction of the force from over 1,000 Rangers to just over 100, but it didn't call for the prosecutions of crimes. And so what that meant was that those hundreds of Texas Rangers that were released from being Texas, from service, for being on the Texas Ranger force, they just went on to be prison guards, sheriff deputies. They worked in local law enforcement. Some of them received federal appointments as immigration officials. And later in 1924, some of them went on to be Border Patrol agents and helped to be the to help shape border policing at a federal level in 1924. Racial violence continued after the 1919 investigation. This is a letter that was posted, published in the Washington Post in 1922, urging Americans in Texas to stop killing Mexicans. So all this to say, very briefly, that Texas Rangers with violent records enjoyed long careers in law enforcement. The Buenavide massacre took place in 1918, as I described. James Monroe Fox, who had been released from service because of his involvement in other Texas Rangers who had been released in service. He is on the left here on horseback, standing next to, I edited this photo or cropped it so that you couldn't see the remains of the dead, but posing next to dead Mexican Americans and Mexican nationals who they labeled as Mexican bandits. And this is the earliest record that I found of James Monroe Fox, who shot Richard Brooks, a young African-American man at 21 years old, who he accused of trying to resist arrest. And so these are the moments in the archive when I think, you know, here's this person who had a long career in law enforcement. What would have happened if he had been removed from law enforcement in 1902 after he shot and killed Richard Brooks? How many other lives could have been saved? And I think that that's the kind of very big abstract question that as historians, we can't answer unless we have a full record of police violence. And he was actually invited back to the Texas Ranger Force in 1925 and in 1934. So I'm just going to quickly move forward to talk about the representative that added the $1 million rider to the 1924 Immigration Act to fund the Border Patrol in 1924, right? So there's deep racist roots of policing in border enforcement, and those roots are in Texas, unfortunately. Kelly Lytle Hernandez, I'm going to just sort of move through quickly for time, but Kelly Lytle Hernandez helped, has documented the role of Texas Rangers in shaping the Border Patrol, but also abuse by the Border Patrol. And you know, so many people who are now reflecting on this early period of racist policing by the Texas Rangers have tried to come to terms with it by saying this is a thing of the past. You know, we the Texas Rangers of today, law enforcement in Texas today, are so far removed from those Texas Rangers. But in fact, Texas Rangers targeted civil rights efforts throughout the 20th century. Immediately after the end of the 1918 investigation of the Texas Rangers, Governor William Hobby called on the Texas Rangers to intimidate and dismantle NAACP chapters in Texas. The NAACP secretary came to Texas to meet with individual chapters, but also to investigate ongoing lynchings that were taking place in Texas. He himself was assaulted by a mob in Austin that included a county judge who later bragged about participating in this act. And Texas Governor Hobby eventually, you know, he sided with the mob and encouraged the NAACP to stay out of Texas. Of course, there people are familiar, more familiar now with the involvement of the Texas Rangers in discouraging integration during the mid-1950s. This is a photograph of Texas Ranger at Mansfield in 1956. Texas Rangers also participated in the 60s and 70s with abuse and violence and a brutality to disrupt farm workers striking for better wages and an end to labor exploitation in the 1960s and 70s. This is Captain Ranger A.Y.L.E., who, if you look at the civil rights archives of the Chicanx movement, he appears in at farm worker strikes, at school walkouts. His intimidation moved him across the state of Texas. And so again, these the questions of trying to remove and displace the history of racist violence against African-Americans and Mexican-Americans in Texas has too swiftly been allocated to the past and not understood as a more recent phenomenon. I'm just gonna move past this to remind us also that the consequences of not taking seriously police brutality and police murder on the US border has had lasting and devastating consequences. So cases filed of Border Patrol abuse just between 2012 and 2015 has also experienced, these agents have also enjoyed a culture of impunity. 95.9% of the over 1,000 cases in which an outcome was reported resulted in no action against the officer or agent accused of misconduct. The complaints contain allegations of many forms of abuse, with physical abuse cited as the reason for the complaint in 59.4% of the cases, and no action was the outcome of many complaints against Border Patrol agents that alleged serious misconduct, such as running over a person with a vehicle, making visible threats, sexually assaulting a woman in a hospital, and denying medical attention. So these abuse by agents on the border is not new, but it continues to be, especially after September 11th, when border policing and enforcement was moved under the Department of Homeland Security, continues to be even further hidden from public view. And so there is a series of reports by the American Immigration Council that have been raising flags about this kind of abuse since 2014 and again in 2017. And James Tomczyk, the CBP head of internal affairs, was quoted as saying, quote, "The green line of silence is higher and wider than it's ever been before. There is a clear understanding on the part of the rank and file of the Border Patrol that if they should engage in whistleblower activities or do anything to promote transparency, that they would be retaliated against in a way that would likely end their career." And so I'll just end by saying that since 2010, over 100 people have been killed by Border Patrol agents, and there's been no meaningful accountability. Six people have been killed by agents firing across the US-Mexico border, including a minor shot 10 times in the back. In 2015, the Supreme Court ruled against the family of Sergio Hernandez, who were seeking monetary damages because he was shot. This 15-year-old boy was shot by a border agent across the border. And of course, children are not protected from these kinds of abuses. A haunting report from the ACLU that was released in 2018 called Neglecting Abuse of Unaccompanied Immigrant Children by U.S. Customs and Border Protection revealed excessive use of force and abuse, unnecessary and punitive use of tasers, verbal threats and abuse, denial of safe, clean, and secure living, denial of drinking water, food, and medical care, failure to protect children from sexual assault and abuse. And in 2019, there were reports that the US government received 4,500 complaints of sexual assault only from 2014 to 2018. And so to end, I mean, it's a deeply troubling history to speak to, for sure, but all the more troubling with histories and conversations that we're having today about ending police brutality. We have so much work to think relationally, to think comparatively, and to not allow things like citizenship to be one of the only thing that that is required for people to have a voice in speaking out against police abuse. And that's more urgent today than it ever has been. And so I'm looking forward to having a conversation about that later in Q&A. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Martinez. We'll turn right away, Dr. Moore.
All right, thank you. What I'll do, I'll try to shorten mine up because I know that the attendees want to talk a little bit. So we'll see if we can get in and out of this as quick as we can. One second. Sorry about that. I got a high school kid here. So I'm gonna try to put one photo up on the screen and then we will be off and running if I can find it. All right. So there's a photograph there, and I want to use this photograph, I would say, as in many ways to, all right, we all see the photograph, but anyway, I want to use this photograph in many ways to sort of show, for this to be sort of the centerpiece of my presentation. And what you have in front of you is what I think is an iconic 20th century African-American photograph, and I just happen to be related to all of these people. On here, my grandparents in the middle, there are 13 children, two in-laws. My mom is in that picture and another in-law. And then there's a granddaughter. So this was taken in Cleveland, Ohio in 1960, less than a year before they all packed up and left Cleveland and went to Compton. So growing up in Cleveland, Ohio was interesting. And when people would ask where your grandparents were from, I would say, well, my mom's parents are from Louisiana and my dad's parents are from Los Angeles. And oftentimes people didn't believe me because it was kind of heard of to somebody being in Cleveland to have, you know, grandparents in Los Angeles. And I think it's one of those deals when you're younger, you think of LA, you're thinking of Hollywood. It's kind of carefree. You got these beaches and nobody can just imagine, you know, you having grandparents in Los Angeles, particularly in the Black community when most of us still had grandparents in the South. It was unique for me to have grandparents in Los Angeles. And I would tell them, I also have 11 aunts and uncles in Los Angeles as well. So that was always interesting. And so the question would always come about, well, how did your dad end up here? And I say, well, when my aunts and uncles and grandparents left, my dad and his one brother, they stayed. So I was a part of the Cleveland Moore. It was two families in Cleveland. We were the Cleveland Moore. My grandmother on the right there, she was a concert pianist at the age of 14. And at the age of 15, she becomes valedictorian of Crispix Attucks High School, which was arguably the best high school in the country. Let me explain. It was created in 1927 because although the schools in Indianapolis were integrated, Black students were kind of scattered. So the Black community of Indianapolis wanted their own Black school. And since the city of Indianapolis was controlled by the Klan, in many ways, they agreed to it. So in 1927, you have this phenomenal high school created in Indianapolis, Indiana. Over 50% of the teachers had master's degrees. Several other teachers in many ways had doctorates. And so that's why it was looked upon as one of the best high schools in the country. So my grandmother graduates from there in 1915. My father-in-law was a jazz musician. He was self-taught after a certain point of time. And then they marry and he gets called to the ministry. He wants to become a pastor. 1933, they get married and they settle into a holiness church, a denomination called the Church of Christ Holiness USA. And this is interesting because oftentimes, again, when we talk about the Great Migration, we don't think about, in many ways, these networks that have been built up through church associations and church denominations. And the Church of Christ Holiness, like I'll explain a little bit, has in many ways functioned as an extended family for the entire Moore family. All right, let me keep it moving. 1944, my grandparents feel the call of God to go to Cleveland, Ohio and pastor a church. So while in Cleveland, my grandfather would deliver mail by day. They said he would come home and put on a shirt and tie after he delivered mail. And he was Pastor Moore when he was at home. And that's when he handled his spiritual obligations. My grandmother, the supreme intellect she was, her primary responsibility was educating the children. And several of my aunts have said that there was an expectation in many ways that academically they would be at or near the top of their class. Now, when they go to Cleveland in the 1940s, and I know people like to joke about Cleveland now, but I'm from Cleveland. I claim Cleveland. It's home for me. Cleveland was considered the best location in the nation for Negroes in the 1940s, early 50s, for several reasons. Number one, it had a booming economy. Number two, it had the highest number of Black council persons of any other major city. We had 6 African-Americans serving on city council. 1956, it had the most Black judges of any major American city in the 1950s. And also the Cleveland Browns and the Cleveland Indians were among the first professional sports franchises to integrate. And lastly, number four, there was no history of racial disturbances or riots in Cleveland. They settled into the Glenville community, which is a large Jewish community. And that is in many ways where they will raise their children. They will go to Glenville High School. My dad goes to Glenville High School, finishes in 1956. Not that you care, but I'll point out my dad. If you start from the right and go left, my dad is standing up and he'll be the second boy from the right. And that's my mom standing next to him. My dad would go to what is now Case Western Reserve University, finished in 1956. He talked about how he would deliver mail during the day and he would run, deliver his route so he could go study. He said he would study at the pool hall sometimes. He finishes in 1956 and he said he wanted in many ways to set an example for his family. He is the second oldest. My grandfather, in addition to pastoring, was very active in the community, block clubs, things of that nature. My aunts recalled that he was very, very good friends with the Jewish rabbi at the end of the street. And so although he was pastoring and delivering mail, he also had in many ways a strong civic orientation. Throughout the 1940s and 50s, my grandfather would go to California a lot preaching revivals. And I think this is where the idea of moving to LA came in. And understand, when you are a Black preacher back in the 40s, 50s, shoot, even the 80s and 90s, when you go speak at another church, it's not like you're gonna speak at that church and go stay at a hotel. No, you're gonna stay at somebody's house. So over time, my grandfather would go to California and preach in these revivals. A lot of time they were 5 nights, Monday through Friday night. You're speaking at the church every night. And he would get to know the people. He would stay in their homes. And so it was during these revivals where we believe that he got the idea of going to Los Angeles. But also there was a desire in many ways. Some of the people in Los Angeles wanted him to come out there to pastor. So I asked some of my aunts, when did you all realize that your parents were serious about just packing up everybody in Cleveland and moving to Los Angeles in 1961? One of my aunts said she knew they were serious when they started packing up. Another aunt said she knew they were serious when they had a going away party at the church and she was crying. I think she was like 10 and she was crying. Now, all of my aunts and uncles weren't excited about going to LA. My aunt Libby said she kind of wanted to stay in Cleveland. She had earned a scholarship to Northwestern, but the scholarship required her to have Cleveland residency, all right? But in those days, when Mr. Moore or Pastor Moore, or when they said we're all going to California, they all went to California. The only two who stayed in Cleveland were my dad and his brother who's sitting right next to him. And when I would talk to my dad about, Dad, why didn't you go to Los Angeles? He worked for the Internal Revenue Service. He could have gotten a job easily. He said he wanted to stay there and look after the church. When my grandfather moved to Cleveland, he pastored a church. He started a church called Glenville Church, started in many ways in his living room. And that church is still operating today. And that is the church that I still consider home. Now, when they were talking about going to Los Angeles, my Aunt Dorothy said she was excited and she had a great coach. She said it was like moving to another country. Then she said this, I was excited about meeting Mexicans. And I even said that I would date a Mexican man when I got there. All right. So the end of the semester, the middle of the semester, they hop on a train. My grandparents, 9 children, 1 grandchild, they go to Chicago and connect with my great aunt. They connect with my aunt Libby, and they all go from Chicago to Los Angeles. My aunt Kathy, the youngest, recalled that the train ride was fun. And she said, we had a life-sized African-American doll on the train and it had its own seat. One of my aunts said she didn't remember much about the train ride from Cleveland to Los Angeles, but she does remember that there were three cars took them to the train station in Cleveland and with all this luggage, and it was a sight to even see them get on the train. One of my aunts said she didn't remember much about the train ride either, but she does remember, she said she felt they were treated like upper class Black folks because she said my mommy and daddy always dressed dignified when they travel. Now, this kind of migration was in many ways unusual. Typically, migrants would leave the South, and wherever they landed, they sometimes stayed. But in this case, my grandparents went from Indianapolis to Cleveland, and then Cleveland to Los Angeles or Compton. Now, once in Los Angeles, they settled in Compton, California. And let me say this, they lived with my Uncle Melvin for a month or so before moving to their own house 5 or 6 blocks away in Compton. So the next time you complain about your in-laws coming to stay with you for a couple of weeks, imagine if your in-laws come and stay with you for a month, and that's about 11 of them. And so my Uncle Melvin, I didn't get a chance to talk to him, but I'm sure that was interesting for him to have his whole family come and camp out with him for a while. So Compton, California, when you hear the phrase Compton now, it is a term that is very popular in American culture, particularly in hip hop culture. But in the 1950s, it was an exemplary suburb. It's a blue collar community with a suburban lifestyle. 1952, Compton gets what they call the All-American Cities Award. And although it is synonymous now with gangsterism and all that kind of stuff, in 1948, Compton had about 45,000 people and less than 50 were Black. And white homeowners in Compton were effectively able to keep out Black folks from the 1950s. They did it through a number of ways: restrictive covenants, redlining, harassment, vandalism, cross burnings. Yes, cross burnings in Compton and other forms of terror. But by 1960, A couple things happened that allow African Americans to move into Compton. Number one, there's still a steady migration from the South into Los Angeles. So those all Black areas in Los Angeles are beginning in many ways to expand. Number two, Black folk had a desire to leave South Central and head to areas such as Crenshaw and Compton. And number three, the Supreme Court outlawed restrictive covenants, those things on housing deeds that said houses couldn't be sold to Negroes, Jews, Irish, Italian, or whatever. However, when Black folks move into Compton, white homeowners aren't happy. Here's what one white homeowner said. In Southern states, they have laws that keep the ends in their place inward. But unfortunately for the white race in this state, there is nothing to control them. I think there should be a separate place for the Negroes to live instead of coming to white communities. Now, when Blacks moved to Compton, understand they were not moving into dilapidated neighborhoods like we saw in Cleveland, Detroit, Chicago, Oakland, places like that. They were moving into wonderful homes. By 1960, 93% of all the Black folks who moved to Compton, they were living in homes that were less than 20 years old. And also the homes in Compton, as one researcher said, tend to be bigger than other areas across the city. And so the 1950s, Compton is sort of an idyllic American suburb, and Black folks will begin to integrate around the time my grandparents get there, 1961 and throughout the 60s. Here's what one person said about the Black folks moving into Compton. Said, Compton has become a city, and this is funny, which sends its Negro high school graduates to state colleges, to Berkeley, UCLA, Compton Community College, and even Fisk, all right? And at the time, Compton Community College was one of the best community colleges in the state. Here's another quote. Our Black neighbors are of a good class. Many buy their own homes and take good care of them. We wouldn't exchange Compton for any other place. But here's the classic quote from a white homeowner. In their mind, they are praising Black people. Listen to this. Of course, we have African Americans moving into our city, and you can't do anything to stop it. But you would be surprised. I'll tell you, though, some of the streets they took over are as clean as anything you want to see. All right. And so there was this impression amongst people, not only in Compton, but outside of Compton, that the Black folk in Compton were just somewhat different. One Riots resident, Riots is a Black community in LA, one Riots resident referred to them, quote, as middle-class Negroes who moved to Compton and who don't care about anybody else, all right? So that was the perception. My Aunt Libby recalled that when they moved to Los Angeles and they went to a church we affiliated with, Christ Temple Church on 54th Street, she said, she started meeting some of the young people. She said, somebody said, quote, y'all talk white, all right? And she also remembered feeling that some of their peers were somewhat envious when they came to Christ Temple Church and they quickly assumed most of the leadership positions as it related to the youth ministry. So in many ways, the Compton that the Moores moved to was this amazing suburb. It was a destination place in many ways. It allowed blue-collar people to have a suburban lifestyle. And many of my aunts and uncles did go to schools in the area. Compton Community College, some of them went to the Cal State schools and also the University of Southern California. Although my grandfather never pastored a church when he moved to Los Angeles, in many ways, he was active on the preaching circuit, all right? He preached at a lot of different places, but was never a pastor. And although he retired from the post office in Cleveland before moving, he had to get another job when he got to Los Angeles because of the cost of living there. Now, the Watts riots, 1965 Watts riots in many ways are interesting for two reasons. Number one, it is the new kind of riot. And I know Professor Joseph doesn't like to use that term. And so we could say uprising or disturbance. But prior to that point, many of the racial riots in America primarily involved white residents going into black and brown neighborhoods and assaulting and killing civilians. But this one is different. This is the first time you begin to see in America African-Americans showing are frustrated. And in many ways, these rebellions or these outbursts in many ways will jump off. But what the Watts riots does, the collateral damage, although it does signal to white America that all is not well in our nation's urban areas, but what it does, particularly for Compton and other parts of Los Angeles, it triggers massive white flight. Researchers say that after Watts was over, a lot of white homeowners left Compton, but not only just homeowners, but also businesses. So you have white residential and also commercial flight. And over time, the tax base in Compton would begin to erode. Also, what was going on in Los Angeles, you have plant closures, you have automation taking place. So between 1965 and 1970, Compton in many ways will be confronted with massive unemployment. Now, by 1973, the LA Times labels Compton, quote, a ghetto of poverty, crime, gang violence, unemployment, and blight. And the group NWA, when they came out in 1998 with that song, F the Police, NWA, Niggas with Attitudes, in many ways, they articulated a lot of the black frustration in many ways that was experienced by black people, not just in Compton, but also in the broader Los Angeles. However, so the Compton that resonates in popular culture today is not the Compton in many ways that my grandparents would remember. They were proud to be there, excited to be there because it represented opportunity. Now, over time, the Moore crew spread throughout other areas of Los Angeles. My Aunt Libby moved to 76 and Butlong, just blocks from where the Rodney King riots would take place. My Uncle Melvin, who was, I think he's 90 now or 91, he still lives in Compton on West 133rd Street, and my grandparents lived on West 138th Street. What is funny is that when I was going through this, they said that when black folks started moving into Compton, white people said, we'll let them move in, but it has to be north of 130th Street. So I found it ironic that my uncle was on 133rd Street and my grandparents were 138th Street. Others moved to Inglewood, including my grandmother. When my grandfather died, he died in 1974. Now, many of my aunts and uncles are out in the Riverside area, the Inland Empire. Four siblings are deceased. My father passed in 2001 and his brother Ralph passed in 2020. Another brother passed also in 2020, right before the pandemic started. But it is an amazing family. Of the original 13 children, four in many ways are deceased. And I'll tell this quick story before I end. My wife always laughs. She said, you know, y'all Moors, y'all go at it. And I tell people when we get together for family events or just hanging out, we don't watch a whole lot of TV. We debate, we argue. And in many ways, that's just how I was raised. You know, my wife couldn't understand. She said, y'all are getting together for Thanksgiving and y'all will start Thanksgiving dinner at 9 o'clock. But we'll talk till 2 or 3 in the morning. And I think in many ways, that is just the legacy carrying over from Ezekiel and Bessie Moore. So this is just an interesting migration story that I wanted to share with you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Leonard. Let's go now to questions. If the audience has any questions, you can either indicate that you'd like to ask a question in the Q&A using the Q&A function, or you can just type in a question there. But while we're waiting, I have to say these were such different presentations from many points of view that I can't say that I see one question that I can ask all of you. I've got one question that I would like to ask each of you, but I don't have one question I can ask all of you. And I think I would start, Leonard, with you and your really fascinating account of your family, and ask what members of your family experienced in LA in the Rodney King, during the Rodney King episode.
Yeah, well, so because I'm such a large family, there are a lot of us first cousins, you know, and I have, I think, 7 or 8 male cousins there. All of us finished high school within 1 or 2 years, and several female cousins. And I'll just tell 2 quick incidents. I was in a car. This was 89. After I finished high school, I was out there for a week visiting my cousins, and we get in this car. And he said, man, they about to pull me over. And I'm like, man, you good, right? He said, yeah. So the cops pull us over and they look at his license registration, but then the cop pulls out a ruler and measures the tire tread on his car. And he gives my cousin a ticket for that. And he said, man, we deal with this every day. A week later, me and all of my cousins are walking through the UCLA community of Westwood. LAPD pulls us, LAPD tells us to get down on our knees, put our hands behind our back, and they ask us what gang we're a part of. And my older cousin, man, is like, no, we are all cousins. And the cops didn't believe it. But what they said was that they dealt with police harassment on a nearly daily basis. One last story. My grandmother died during or right after the 1984 Summer Olympics. And my father said when they were leaving the funeral home, making their arrangements, him and his 3 brothers, a cop pulled them over and just really harassed all 4 of them because one of my uncle's taillights was out. And you know, so understand that when the riots jumped off, I knew what the frustration was around the LAPD because I had experienced it myself, although on a minor scale.
Thank you. Any question here? So, Peniel, I would like to ask you, since you corrected my language, what you would recommend to use and why. In terms of talking about ethnic groups or racial groups that are not, that do not have the highest percentage of population in the United States, what terms would you use? And why is, and I think what's important here, why is it important?
Well, yeah, I think, you know, I think there's a number of things. One, like what Leonard just said is why I call them rebellions, right? And I always explain to students that these are all ideologically loaded words. If somebody's telling you there's such a thing as objectivity in the academy, they're lying to you. It's all subjective. So I call them urban rebellions because Black people are human beings. I stand with Malcolm X where I don't play the dozens with white folks about Black humanity. I'm not in a debate with white people about Black humanity. Dr. King got into a debate with white people about Black humanity. That's why Malcolm's one of my heroes. So, you know, one, we're human beings. So the abuse that Leonard was talking about that we face, that Monica has written about, terms of the violence never leaves you. I've read her book. It's brilliant. It's we're human beings, so it's a rebellion when you're being dehumanized. So that's one. Two, you know, when you think about race and ethnicity, globally, we're the majority. Globally, we're the majority. So the idea that we are somehow racial minorities in the United States is just a rhetorical sleight of hand by white supremacists. You know what I mean? And so once you figure that out, all I'm doing as a professor is trying to teach people to say, hey, when people use those terms, they're wrong. Just like I always tell people, and I'm 48, I've been telling these to people for over a quarter of a century, there's no such thing as second-class citizenship in a democracy. So even when Black people say, oh, we were second-class citizens, they're absolutely wrong. And I've told people that, including my own pastor, because I'm a good Christian boy too. There's no such thing as second-class citizenship in a democracy. So all these things, if we're educators, we have to teach and be lifelong students. So one, we're not minorities. Two, white folks can call them riots and Black Uncle Toms can call them riots. They were always rebellions because we were being dehumanized. The reason why Black kids screamed at civil rights activists in Ferguson is because civil rights activists lied to them in Ferguson and said that they won. in 2014 and 15. They knew they were living below the poverty line and they hadn't won anything. So the truth shall set you free. That's what the Bible teaches us, right? So we have to constantly be searching for the truth. Reason why Dr. King is one of my heroes too, is at the end of his life, he becomes a prophetic figure in the lens of Amos and Jeremiah and an Old Testament prophet speaking the truth. And guess what? White folks no longer like Dr. King once he's speaking the truth, because you can't negotiate with white supremacists. You can't tell white supremacists they're white supremacists and expect standing ovations. But guess what? You're speaking truth to power and you're saving your soul every time you do so. So we're not racial minorities. We're not animals. They weren't riots. They were rebellions. And this continues to happen because we lack the power to defeat white supremacy. Everything that's happening right now in the United States was happening during the first Reconstruction and the second Reconstruction. And it's all happening right in front of our eyes. And we're seeing that white supremacy is as vicious now as it was then. Mitch McConnell is the same thing as Benjamin Tillman and the red shirts, okay? What you're seeing in the US Senate and the Congress is the same thing you saw in the Reconstruction governments, Louisiana, New Orleans, the white mobs murdering Black people in Texas. This is all wash, rinse, and repeat, right? And the one thing they hate for us to do, which is why Georgia, on top of voting suppression, is telling people they can't talk about white supremacy. White supremacists hate it when you talk about what? White supremacy, right? Right? So those are all terms that I'll tell students, look, you have to know why you're saying something. So civil disturbance is an ideologically loaded term. Riot is an ideologically loaded term, and so is rebellion. It's a rebellion because people who are human beings should not be mistreated. And after a while, they explode when they're constantly mistreated.
Okay, I would love to continue the conversation, but I think we should move on. And I hope I can get to you, Monica, but we have a couple of questions. Brittany?
Yes, okay. So I will read out the typed questions just so everybody is on the same page. First question comes from Michelle Perenzino, who asks, was the rise of quote unquote gangster rap music in Compton a new expression of Black power?
That's a stretch there. Now, understand NWA, although they were articulating the frustration of the masses, they weren't really living that life. You know what I mean? And so it becomes something bought, packaged, and sold for Hollywood. But I do believe that for people in LA, they could really relate, you know, to NWA. And that's why, you know, and I never saw all the gangsterism. I don't know, maybe I was in the wrong part, but even, you know, even now my Uncle Street is, you know, like, man, it's like a, you know, a decent place. So I wouldn't go so far as to say it's Black power. I think they were just articulating the frustrations of the masses.
Thank you. We have a question from Dr. Hardwick, who says these talks were so compelling. Could any of you talk about gender as a dynamic in these forms of violence, masculinity, as well as in terms of women? So does anyone want to start there?
Monica, you start. I'll follow.
Yeah, well, you know, I'd like to build on something also that Dr. Joseph said about exposing the roots of white supremacy. And it's actually not that hard to do if you look at the historical record. But also, if you just look at our contemporary rhetoric that's being used by politicians and members of Congress. So when we look at the history, also, if we look at people like you know, Attorney General Jeff Sessions, right? He very clearly spoke fondly about the 1924 Immigration Act as a model for restricting numbers of legal immigration into the United States when he was the Attorney General, right? The 1924 Immigration Act was designed by eugenicists. And so people, congressmen who advocated for race-based national quotas called eugenicists in to testify before Congress to speak about the racial inferiority of Mexicans, but also to advocate, to say, look, the original sin of slavery, not because it was immoral, but because now we have all of these Black people here. And so we actually have to restrict immigration immediately to protect the white race and to make sure that the United States was imagined and built for white people. And so, you know, when we're thinking about exposing white supremacy, we have to think about it in terms of exposing it in all of its power structures, but immigration is certainly one of these fields where it has been overlooked and forgotten. I will say that in terms of thinking about recovering cases of police violence against women, it is something that I've also been surprised by how many cases of children, but also young women. So that newspaper article that I showed from the Washington Post, this Mexican diplomat gave an example of a young girl, a Mexican American girl who was 14 years old, who was shot by police who were raiding homes looking for smugglers. And so anti-racist violence by police primarily targeted, and we look at the records, primarily targeted men and young boys, but young girls and women also were victims. It's also harder to find cases of sexual abuse because those records are even more obscured and harder to find, but also those cases have not been preserved in family community memories in the same way that people have remembered lynchings and passed those histories on from generation to generation. So archivally, it is also a harder kind of violence, sexual violence by police. It's harder to record those cases, although we know that they took place in the early 20th century.
Yeah, and I'll just quickly say, in terms of the gendered aspect, I think what we see, especially with so much great stuff on criminal justice and gender, is that in the aggregate, there are more Black men in prison, but Black women are going to prison right now at a faster rate. And then when you think about gender violence in LA, when you look at Beth Ritchie and Arrested Justice, when you look at Bren Stevenson and her work on Latasha Harlins, when you look at what people are, you know, there's a gendered nature to the violence that, like Kimberly Crenshaw and the African-American Women's Public Policy Forum examines, where we even as Black women, we're very, very vulnerable in different ways, because that's the whole thing. Both the entire community is vulnerable, and then Black women and men are both vulnerable in different ways. A lot of times we gendered our language discursively when we dealt with the problem. I think a great example in a modern sense was when Barack Obama did My Brother's Keeper for young Black men, which was actually a good idea, but he had to be pressured to do a similar program for Black girls, young Black girls. So I think part of the pain and the trauma and why people are pushing for intersectional justice, it's not about leaving either group behind. When you think about young boys versus young girls, it's saying that, and parents know this, boys and girls are going to have different traumas, different pains, different joys, and at times they're going to converge. And it's about how do we deal with both of them with equality and equity and respect. And when you think about equity, it means that to get equity, sometimes you have to spend more time and investment on certain people than others to get equity. It doesn't mean you hate anybody. It means if we're all going to get $1,000, some of us need $500. Some of us don't need anything. And we shouldn't be upset, those of us who say, man, how come I'm not getting a check? You've got the money right behind you, right? But we still get upset in this society because we think equity, equality are the same thing. Yeah.
Dr. Moore, do you have something you want to say on that?
I was thinking about that. I just wonder, you know, thinking about my, you know, my grandmother, you know, how brilliant she was, you know, what, you know, if more opportunities would have been available for African-American women at the time, you know what I mean? You know, you finish high school, 15 valedictorian, you know, how things would have turned out. I think about my aunt, you know, with the scholarship, you know, to Northwestern in 1960, you know, how things may have been different for her, you know what I mean? And I think a lot of Black men at the time were very protective of their spouse and their daughters, especially. And I remember I was talking to my students, my mom never worked outside the house. And my dad said that when they first got married, so my mom was from rural Louisiana. She was used to working, all right? She said, so they moved to Cleveland, 1959, get married. She's a 23-year-old girl from rural Louisiana. My dad goes down to the big office at Internal Revenue Service, downtown Cleveland. My mom was like, I'm going to get a job. So she went and got a job at a restaurant at a waitress. And so she called my dad at work. She said, just letting you know, I won't be home when you get there because I just got a job. And he said, where are you at? And she said, I'm at this like a Woolworths cafeteria. He left work and went down there and told her no. And so some people look at that as chauvinism or sexist, but his thing was he didn't want his wife to be subject to a lot of harassment, all right? Because he said he'd heard the experience of Black women around white men. And so his thing was, let me make enough money so my wife doesn't have to work. Now, we look at it differently, but I think there is this idea of protecting.
Okay, we need to wrap up in a couple of minutes, but I do want to come back to Dr. Martinez. I didn't ask my one question of her. And what I found fascinating in your talk was the use of documents that you've made, of these documents that do not necessarily say anything about people who were killed, but who were brutalized. And I just wonder how much material of that kind you found, since you do very quantitative work. Maybe you can give us an idea.
We're still, unfortunately, we're still recovering cases. And so there's certainly hundreds of cases of lynchings and murders that we found, but oftentimes, well, the 1918 investigation is certainly the kind of document that I've moved from beginning to end to pull out all of the cases. And that has a series of cases where people are testifying to the kinds of brutality that they experienced that didn't result in death. But that's the kind of work that we only just have a glimpse into. Many of the cases of this kind of brutality, this is kind of every day, as Dr. Moore was describing his own family experience with harassment by police. But certainly when people were beat or hospitalized because of interactions with police, that requires actually doing a comprehensive survey of media reports, but also of newspaper reports by the Black press, Spanish language press, because of course, when you're using state archives and police records, these are corrupt records. And so even in the cases where people were murdered by police, police often didn't document them and coroners didn't issue death certificates. And so it's even more challenging to record those cases, which is why it's so miraculous to have this investigation in 1919, which I think tells us so much about the work yet to be done in recovering these cases, but also is a reminder for today about ongoing efforts to reform police and how they've continued to fail, not for effort, but because of the structures of power that have prevented them from succeeding. And so 1918 is really this year where you see the state making a decision. I can either work with anti-lynching activists and I can work with this congressman to reform policing. And instead they decide to continue endorsing violence, both by vigilantes and by police. And so we are living in the world today that was made by a series of decisions like made by Governor Hobby in 1919. And so that record helps to just give us a glimpse into some of these cases. Yeah.
Thank you. And I wanted to draw this to a close by thanking all of you. I think it was certainly a very rich and varied discussion, and we could have gone on much longer. I also want to thank the participants out there in cyberspace. And I especially want to thank Courtney Mador for her work behind the scenes that always makes these panels happen. And Brittany for her readiness to do the very difficult work of fielding questions. So thank you all. And I hope to see you at other Institute events soon.
Thank you.